Trinity Christian High School in Deltona. And you see the size, 6'7", nearly 250, rocket arm with deadly accuracy. Scouts in the NFL are salivating over this guy right now, and rightfully so. Fake to Anthony Miller, downfield across the 40. Sprinting down the sideline, deep inside of Navy territory, it is Daniel Montiel.
We see the movement right here by Paxton Lynch, and that's one of the things that this 6'7 kid can do really well. And Montiel is the online tight end, and this time he goes clear across the formation and sneaks behind that coverage, very well disguised.
On first down, Miller. Good blocking outside. And Miller gets shoved down, got a seal block from Mose Frazier, and he works towards the 10-yard line.
Adam, we saw Daniel Montiel, and we'll also see Allen Cross, two very, very good tight ends in this spread system as well.
Memphis speeding it up, swinging out to Miller again, another block from Frazier, and Anthony Miller diving to the pylon, touchdown Tigers!
Miller makes a great effort on the quick screen outside, a very good block out on the edge by Frazier, and then right here the effort. If he's in bounds and just touches that pylon, that's a touchdown. That's very well called on the field.
Leading receiver Anthony Miller, very involved on that drive where Lynch went 4-of-4 for 85 yards. Three of those completions were to Miller. The 60-yarder from Montiel helped set it up. Jake Elliott, outstanding kicker, makes it 7-0. This is a Memphis offense that has gotten off to slow start after slow start all season long. For the first time since the opening game of the season, the Tigers score on their opening drive, exactly what they wanted.
Brought to you by Pennzoil Synthetics. Make the switch to Pennzoil Synthetics today. And Go RVing. Find your away at GoRVing.com.
One of the high-powered offenses in college football. Memphis, third in the nation in scoring behind Baylor and TCU. Didn't take them long. Got into the end zone very quickly. Anthony Miller had three receptions, including the touchdown grab. Jake Elliott kicking away for the Tigers. Very good touchback kicker. And Dyson Romine will wave it out. Navy out to the 25-yard line. And Olivia Harlan, it's a big night for Keenan Reynolds.
Yeah, Adam, and Keenan Reynolds told me he's ready to get this over with. Now, he's not ungrateful, and he does understand the importance of it. He just wants the focus to be back on the team's race for the division title. But, boy, he would love it to come tonight, though, in his home state of Tennessee, where he started playing football, always a quarterback, at age 5. This morning, I talked to his high school coach, David Martin, who said he's not surprised at all by his success. Reynolds started all 4 years for him at Good Pastor Christian, just outside of Nashville. And it was actually his older teammate, Benny Cunningham, who now plays for the St. Louis Rams, that told Coach Martin to start him his freshman year. He's got his whole family here, guys, and his mom even said they would charter a bus.
The first snap out of the hands of Keenan Reynolds, and he's able to get back on top of it, recover the fumble. It'll be a loss of 4, not the start that Keenan Reynolds was hoping for. Olivia mentioned the family is here. His father, Donnie, who was a player at Tennessee Martin to the left. His little brother, Quentin, in the middle there. And then on the right, in the gray sweatshirt, that's his mother, Jackie, whom Olivia mentioned a moment ago. They're all here. Plenty of family and friends. 220 miles away, Antioch, Tennessee. Second down, 14 for this triple option offense. And it is a pitch to the outside for Sanders. And the Brandon Sanders gets dragged down close to the sticks. Good maintenance play to set up third and manageable.
And Adam, that's what we're going to see is Keenan Reynolds is a surgeon at the line of scrimmage running that triple option, and they're going a little bit hurry up right here.
For a hard count for Reynolds, and now he'll check. He's got a lot of freedom in this triple option offense. Averaging 320 rushing yards per game, third in the country. Pitch again, Sanders, first down. Navy very good on third down and fourth down, oftentimes in four down territory, and this is one of the most difficult offenses, and you hear it all the time, most difficult offenses in college football to prepare for.
Yeah, the triple option is very hard to duplicate with your scout team in practice. The speed of it, the precision of it, and Navy is probably the best team right now at doing this thing in college football. You'll see a lot of this out of Reynolds. Goes to the line of scrimmage. You can go hurry up if you want to, but typically he backs away from the line of scrimmage. A lot like Peyton Manning, he loves the chess game at the line of scrimmage once he gets to see the defense.
Play clock had not started once Navy had lined up.
12-13 on the game clock.
So Adam Savoy will clean that up, and they'll get set for this first down from the 37. Keenan Reynolds, 5'11", 205 pounds, not a big guy, but a great fit for this triple option offense led by Ken Niumatalolo and offensive coordinator Ivan Jasper. Take the dive. Here is Romine. Dyson Romine gets brought down quickly. This is the triple option offense in its essence.
Yeah, Keenan Williams is very good at it. First of all, he has a dive key right there. If that defensive player takes the fullback, he takes it to the edge as he's getting an arc block that's going to cut the safety to the ground. And if the defender comes to the quarterback, he makes a feathery pitch outside. And that's the triple option and very, very difficult to defend.
Only Georgia Southern and Air Force average more rushing yards per game than Navy does. They're coming off 428 rushing yards last week and a win over South Florida, 29-17. This time it's a give to the fullback, Quinton Ezell. He gets stacked up for a loss. This Memphis defense trying to stand strong. Third down coming up for Navy, and we take a look at your Chick-fil-A impact players when Navy's on the ball.
Well, we're going to say this a lot. Chris Swain is the fullback. They're going to establish him inside and then work outside. And Jermaine Tillman is the big play receiver outside. Pennington and Pegues is going to have to defend the fullback here tonight if Memphis is going to have a chance in this game.
49% on third down this season. It's only the 98th time that Navy has seen a third down this year. That's a relatively low number for teams in this conference. Reynolds will keep it for the first time, and he's got the first down, diving into Memphis territory, chopped down by Chris Morley, the safety.
And third and two is the absolute wheelhouse of this team, and this is a speed option, somewhat of a changeup. You see Reynolds attacking the end man on the line of scrimmage. He has a running back and pitch relationship, and so that's a changeup, but the core of this offense is truly the triple option.
Seventh play of this drive, as you can imagine, for Navy, which does not pass the ball very often, all runs so far. And man, do they possess the ball and churn a whole lot of clock. To give to the fullback, Chris Swain, who's this team's second leading rusher behind Keenan Reynolds, coming off 131 yards last week. 5 yards on that play. How about this? 1879 was the first year of Navy football. They ran the triple option, not the entire time, but a good chunk of it. But last week was the first time in their history they had three different 100-yard rushers in that victory over South Florida.
That is very difficult to believe.
Yeah.
I had to make you say that again in our production meeting. I did not buy that one the first time around.
So far, five different men have carried it for Navy. Fake the dive. Reynolds will keep it. He's got another first down, and Morley upends him after he picks up the necessary yardage inside the 35. Now, last week against South Florida, Reynolds had 117. Swain had a very solid game, his fourth career 100-yard game. And Dyson Romine, his first ever 100-yard game last week. Regis Ball on that tackle was in the fray, and he is very slow to get up, and he's going to need some help getting off the field. We'll step aside. Navy driving right now.
Unforgettable happens here. And K Jewelers, every kiss begins with K.
Pouncer was enjoying it last night at the homecoming parade and pep rally here in Memphis. University of Memphis, over 100 years old now. Gotta love the mighty sound of the South, the great band for the Memphis Tigers as well. Adam Amin, Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan, huge game in the American Conference with playoff implications, New Year's Six Bowl implications. Memphis quickly scored on its opening touch. Navy on a long drive to start its night offensively 6 minutes in. And Keenan Reynolds, his next rushing touchdown, will be the one that caps the all-time record. Here is Swain, pounded down immediately in the thick of things in the middle there by Sharif White, along with Noah Robinson. Second down.
Adam, typically in this triple option offense, the fullback gets more than a third of the carries, usually in the probably 30 to 35 percentile, and then the quarterback is next, and then they get onto the edge with those slot backs, and we've already seen that early in this game. Usually this offense builds from the inside and expands to the outside, and by the time they get to the outside, this offense is gashing you.
Tenth play, tenth run. This time a pitch to the outside for Calvin Cass Jr. And he gets barreled down by Winton McManus after picking up the first down to the 20-yard line.
So it's the dive read to begin with by Keenan Reynolds. He pulls it when the fullback gets tackled and then gets to the edge. And in this case, makes a very quick pitch right there. Only takes about two steps and then the pitch goes out. He makes about three decisions in a matter of about a second and a half right there.
Ken Niumatalolo said the thing that separates Keenan Reynolds in this offense is his decision making. Not many have ran the triple option, and the numbers show it, as well as Keenan Reynolds has. Trying to make the decision that time. That was well covered. Dontrell Nelson, the cornerback, came up in the coverage to try to help out and made the stop. It'll be second down.
The second time we've seen that speed option getting out to the edge.
This is what we're talking about. The FBS all-time leaders in career rushing touchdowns. Monte Ball with 77. Keenan Reynolds with 77. Monte Ball did it in 49 games. This is career game number 44 for Keenan Reynolds. Second down from the 20. Swain putting that shoulder down, and he runs right into Deshaun Terry after a solid run to the 13. It'll be third and three.
One of the things that this triple option approach does to a defense, you have to be so assignment sound that it really has a knack of slowing a defense down, because defenders are now thinking so methodically about their carrying out their assignment. Excuse me, Adam. Once again, you see Navy in their wheelhouse down and distance-wise.
They've had third and one and third and two and converted already. They're going to go option right this time, and Reynolds will keep it and get another first down. Staying on his feet, it'll be first and goal for Navy.
The use of the speed option, you see the fullback leading up, and then it's the pitch relationship outside, and then Keenan Reynolds attacking the end man on the line of scrimmage, and once again being decisive, knowing what he needs to extend this drive.
He did it on the fifth first down of this opening drive. 13 plays, 66 yards down the field, taking more than 7 minutes off the clock. Immediate pitch. This is Romine, and Romine very close to the goal line. It'll be second down and goal. Olivia told us that Keenan Reynolds would love to get this record out of the way. They're in prime territory to try and do it. Donnie, Quentin, and Jackie all looking on. Donnie was his first ever coach when Keenan was 5 years old. He was groomed to be a quarterback. He's got an opportunity to make history.
I would be amazed if Keenan Reynolds lets score this football right here.
Reynolds held on to it, and he got swallowed up immediately by Winton McManus. Tackle for loss from the edge and a loss of two. It'll be third down and goal.
McManus gets such quick penetration, and he has the quarterback. That's why he can be sold out on this. You can see right there, beating the block of the wide receiver, Tillman, that time. and just slicing into the quarterback. I think we weren't the only ones expecting number 19, Keenan Reynolds, to keep the football right there.
And Navy's going to call a timeout.
Timeout. Navy, they're first.
Third and goal on the other side. So much weight on Keenan Reynolds' shoulders right now. We're only in the first quarter. He's in 77 for his career. Potentially two snaps to try to get into the end zone and have the record to himself, surpassing Monte Ball. Third and goal on what has been a near 9-minute drive, the 16th play. It is a pitch. Swain cutting it up the field, and he'll dive into the end zone for a touchdown. Navy doing what they do, taking time off the clock and pounding it in with a rushing touchdown.
You talked about it, the 16th play, and they finally get in the end zone. 9 minutes, and I guarantee you that Keenan Reynolds does not care who scores. That's the way he feels about that record, and Swain takes it in. His parents don't care either. Just get us a touchdown. They had to answer Memphis's quick start, and they did it in a huge way in a prototypical drive.
Austin Grebe, a very good kicker in his own right for Navy, ties the game at 7 apiece. We told you at the top, so much at stake, not only historically, but in this conference, in the playoff potentially, completely different styles, and we saw both on display in the first scores. Chris, how incredible is this? Remember, this was a team in Ole Miss that Memphis beat by two scores. That's the signature win that has helped Memphis work into the top 15 in the college football playoff rankings. Now what does that mean for the bigger scope? Jalen Oglesby on the return, the freshman out across the 20, and he gets barreled down by Williams. So Paxton Lynch, after a very quick drive, goes back out on the field. Why do scouts love this guy?
He's a freak of an athlete. The arm talent is obvious. He throws a seed from the far hash. And right here, it's not only the movement, but it's the awareness of when to move and get the most out of it. And he's a very fluid athlete. And then he has such good feet. He throws the ball on rhythm, on time, on target most of the time. 6'7", pressing in on 250, and still room to grow. This guy may be the face of an NFL team this time a year from now.
They only needed four plays to score on their first drive. Lynch off play action. Has the check down on the outside for the man who got the fake, Dorlan Dorcius, the redshirt sophomore out of New Orleans. If you ask our Todd McShay who the top five quarterback prospects are right now, he grades Paxton Lynch, partially because of his size, but certainly because of his skill set, over Jared Goff. Now, most mock drafts will still have Jared Goff slotted higher than Paxton Lynch. Swings it out to the left side for Tevin Jones, and he could not hang on. It is ruled an incomplete pass with Quincy Adams in coverage, and it brings up third down and 10.
And the thing about Lynch is, you know, he's still fairly raw.
Yeah.
He played in kind of a run-style offense in high school. He outgrew the running back position, but he wanted to be a quarterback. He was 6'7". He's put on weight. He's gotten stronger. He's much stronger in the pocket this year than he was a year ago. And he's a very intriguing talent for the next level.
Four-man rush on third down. Look at the bullet over the middle for a first down out across the 40 to Phil Mayhew.
And Adam, that's the thing that jumps out right now is his pocket awareness. Lynch is getting much better in the pocket. You know, fluid athletes sometimes have a hard time staying home, and he's learning the value of it.
Another throw, and into Navy territory, Mayhew back-to-back long plays as he picks up the catch and another first down. Navy, 16 runs. Memphis, 8 passes. Completely different styles, two very effective and successful teams. What a great matchup tonight, maybe under the radar with all the great games going on tonight. First run of the night for Dorcius, and he takes it inside the 45-yard line into Bernard Serra. This is what we're talking about. Navy scoring drive, 9 minutes, went over 16 plays. Memphis, it took 81 seconds.
And Navy, meanwhile, wants to keep the ball away from this guy.
Yeah. Lynch swinging it out for Moe's Frazier. Very dangerous in multiple facets. Gets swallowed up by Laurentez Barber. And it'll set up a makeable third down and three at the 38-yard line.
Yeah, and we talked about Navy wanting to establish the fullback, and they'll keep going back to Chris Swain. Memphis will throw screens until you cover them. They will go one side to the other and keep throwing screens. It's kind of their fullback in this offense.
Much like Navy, very good on third down is Memphis this season, near 50%. Lynch can move. Hey, he can throw the option pitch too. And Dorsius drags Barber for a first down inside the 35.
We've seen Keenan Reynolds running this speed option, and now we see Lynch doing it. Attacking number three, Brandon Jones, pitches it at the right time. He presses that defender and then pitches it back. That was well executed. He's not supposed to be doing that.
This is a give to Dorsius, trying to slip free. Breaks one tackle from Daniel Gonzalez, and then Micah Thomas, the team's leading tackler, swallows him up after he picks up additional yardage. 7-yard run for Dorsius, one of four different running backs that is in the rotation for Memphis. Dorsius is their leading rusher. He's had two big games the last 2 weeks. Play action. Good blitz pickup by Dorsius, and here's the athleticism of Lynch on display and the arm, but an incomplete pass looking for Mayhew at the 10. Good coverage by Brandon Clements. Third down.
That's where we see the movement of Jordan or Paxton Lynch. Remember, he's 6'7", almost 250 pounds. Initially, he just climbs in the pocket, keeps his feet moving, nothing there. And now it's time to escape, and he has the fluidity to get outside. He doesn't throw an accurate pass on this particular one. Typically, he does. He completes 7 out of 10 of his throws. But the movement by this big athlete is pretty impressive.
Lynch will keep it. That big body breaks one tackle, and he lunges forward to move the ball across the line to gain as Jarvis Polu brought him down. But this is going to depend on the spot. And looks like the officials have marked it, according to our unofficial line, short.
And this is where typically you would think quarterback sneak with a quarterback that size at 6'7", 250, but you're in the shotcut. That line to gain, you can see right there, our line is pretty accurate, and I think he had it unless the knee was down first. I think they're going to stop this and take a closer look at it.
Yep, indeed they are. Jack Kramer is our replay official.
I mean, the dude is 6'7", long arms, and it seemed to me he reached past that.
We'll step aside. The spot of the ball under review after this. On the field stands. There was not indisputable video evidence to overturn the initial spot. They actually, after we got a second look at it, they very accurately spotted this football. So it's fourth down and inches. They will run it, trying to sneak forward Dorsius, and he's got the first down to the 22-yard line. Even though he was driven back, it seemed like the linesman had come in and already ruled the forward progress past the line to gain.
It looked to me like this ball may have actually been out at the very end. I'm not sure the knee was down before Dorsius, but that ball comes out. He's still on a pile of bodies there, but they called the ball down anyway.
Well, first down from the 22-yard line. Dorsius again. This time gets stacked up right at the line of scrimmage by Amos Mason, along with Quincy Adams. Big body Mason right there, and it brings up second down.
And what Navy wants to do defensively, they have a three-man front, and they're really the ultimate bend-but-don't-break scheme on the defensive side. They want to build structure on the back end, and their three defensive linemen just want to kind of hold the fort and keep offensive linemen off those linebackers and let them roam free.
It's a very hard-hitting 3-4 Navy defense. That brings pressure. Lynch to the end zone. And it's incomplete, looking for Cross. That excellent pass-catching tight end reaching high. And it's third down.
And Paxton Lynch just a little bit off tonight on a couple of those throws. That time, Cross was going down the seam. And this was a nice touch pass. and he didn't lead it inside because you could see that free safety sneaking over the top. And so the quarterback tried to hit on the back number, and he was just a little high and outside.
2 for 3 on third down so far, the Tigers. Four-man rush for Navy. Lynch to the end zone, and it's incomplete with Tevin Jones streaking down the seam. Could not connect, and it's fourth down.
It's something to keep in mind tonight that Paxton Lynch. How many times am I going to say that?
Reminds you a little bit about Jordan Lynch.
Moves the same way. Is bigger than that guy, though, but remember that this offense isn't going to probably get the touches that they're used to because Navy's ability to possess the football offensively. So that 3 and out was huge for them.
Jake Elliott, one of the best kickers in college football. One of the best deep ball kickers as well. And this one from 40 was no problem for Elliott, who's now by himself in the Memphis record books, second all time with 52 career field goals. Only Steven Gostkowski has more with 70. The junior has been dynamite. Well, we're talking about college football playoff rankings. Ole Miss is probably going to drop because they just lost to Arkansas. TCU might drop as well as they were knocked off the ladder of the unbeaten by Oklahoma State today. Our college football playoff top 25 ranking show presented by Northwestern Mutual comes your way Tuesday night at 7 o'clock Eastern on ESPN as we take a look at our all-state college football playoff rankings here. Again, Clemson got the win at home against Florida State in a good battle. LSU, Alabama later on tonight. And again, TCU, a 20-point loss at Oklahoma State. Iowa, with a very good surge, was able to beat Indiana to stay unbeaten. Only 9 teams are still unbeaten. 2 of them are in the American Conference, Memphis and Houston.
We're still pressing for complete chaos, though, right, partner? That's what we're looking for, ultimately.
This is Dyson Romine. It's tackled in the open field by Deshaun Terry. This is the biggest win for Memphis in terms of the resume building so far this year. Remember, they got down quickly, 14-0 against Ole Miss earlier this season, but Lynch was outstanding in this game. The defense really held strong. It's one of the 5 times that Memphis has come from behind from double digits to win a game this year. That throw has NFL scouts salivating all over Lynch. And Justin Fuente, who has turned this Memphis program around completely, has this team sitting at 8-0 right now. We'll see how that loss maybe affects the Memphis resume with the Ole Miss loss earlier today to Arkansas. Jameer Tillman on the first Navy pass picks up 5 yards as the first quarter comes to a close. Keenan Reynolds still sitting at 77 career rushing touchdowns. We talked about the clash of styles between these two teams. If you're a college football fan, a true fan of the sport,
you love this
game tonight. A lot of implications. Top of the West Division is up for grabs between Memphis and Navy in the first ever meeting all time. The quick strike Tigers score. The driving midshipman score to 10-7 Tiger lead through 1. Back in Memphis, college football primetime on ESPN. Navy 6-1, Memphis one of the 9 remaining unbeaten teams in college football. And Damon Brown taking it off the edge with a really strong run out to the 35-yard line, shouldered out by Chris Morley. We'll spot him at the 38.
Watch the good block right here. The running backs block well for each other. The arc released by goalie, and he cuts the safety to the ground. We're going to see so much of that, regardless of who's trying to get it to the edge. And we've seen the quarterback get out there already. A lot of times it's the pitch man, but those slot backs block very well for one another.
One of the toughest offenses in college football to prepare for. Galen Scott is the defensive coordinator for Memphis in his 6th season. Give up the middle to Chris Swain as we check in with Chris Cotter in the studio.
Gentlemen, time for a Taco Bell studio update. Number 7, Michigan State at Nebraska. Tommy Armstrong Jr. is going to roll to his right. He's going to hit Jordan Westerkamp back into the end zone. Great catch, great mustache for Westerkamp. Flag was on Michigan State. Nebraska leads.
Good stuff, Cox. Second down, 7 for Navy here. This is Quinton Ezell. He's got the first down. We said it's a tough offense to prepare for. Olivia, Galen Scott is in his sixth year on staff, first year as the DC.
Yeah, Adam, and his first game tonight preparing against the triple option. Kelly, like you said, that's hard to simulate in practice, and this Navy version is intense, he says. They have 19 different unbalanced looks. On the last drive, Chris Wayne rushed it for a touchdown, and when everyone came to the sideline, Coach Scott just said, keep your eyes up, a little frustrated early on.
Remember, Barry Odom was the defensive coordinator for a very good Memphis defense last year, but they lost Barry Odom as he went back to Missouri, and they lost 12 seniors and 8 starters off last year's defense. First down, 10. Here's the big body of Ezell taking it for about 3 yards.
And the fullback is really the temperature taker of the defense. This triple option never wanders too far away from establishing the fullback so eventually they can get to the edge. And their fullbacks are huge.
Yeah.
245, 253, 255. So you have to want to come up and tackle those guys as well.
Yeah, Ezell's the 253-pounder, Navy's biggest fullback in the triple option era that gets a significant amount of carries. Reynolds keeps it this time, and he gets just bumped down immediately by Leonard Pegues. He's the Mike linebacker. He's one of the best tacklers on this team. He has to be the anchor on this defense.
Yeah, Donald Pennington is the nose tackle in front of him that keeps the center off of 53 Pegues, and you see it right there. Beats his blocker and then go find the quarterback. That's his job. Fullback to quarterback, and then you scrape to the outside.
Memphis's rush defense has not been bad this year. This is a whole new animal to deal with, but they are top 25 in the country in rushing defense. Reynolds, little misdirection, and he's going to get swallowed up by Pegues. Excellent job to keep his lane by Pegues, and this is a rare Navy punt. They like to go for it on fourth down about the 50-yard line in, but they're going to punt it away.
Yeah, fourth and 8 may be a little bit too much to do that early in the game, but sure. You're exactly right. They like to go for it on fourth, and they've been very, very efficient at doing just that.
Alex Barta, the junior out of Clarkston, Michigan, will punt to Miller. Very good punt by Barta as he pins it at the sideline, inside the 5, all the way down to the 1 yard line. Outstanding work by Barta, who's won this job over Gavin Jernigan, and he pins the explosive Memphis Tigers deep in their own territory. Only about a 20-mile trip away from Graceland. Always got to love to see Elvis himself. Look out for the Taco Bell student section and passionate fans like these at games all season long. You can go to ESPN.com/Taco Bell and learn how you can get to the college football playoff. Year 2 of the college football playoff era, and Memphis with an outside shot. Still on the outside looking in, but at number 13 in the initial college football playoff rankings, they're in good shape, undefeated. But a long field in front of Paxton Lynch, who moves the pocket and has a man downfield. A twisting catch by Miller, inbounds. Make that Frazier. Moses Frazier at the 34.
Backed up in your own end zone. When you have a quarterback that can move like Lynch, you can do things like this. And the defense obviously wasn't ready for Anthony Miller to run a seam route, or actually a fade route, and then the quarterback puts it on him.
Again, they're going to need to review this. It was very close along the sidelines for Moses Frazier.
Ruling on the field is a completed pass. Previous play is under further review.
So Jack Kramer in the replay booth is going to take a look at it, see whether or not Frazier kept that foot in bounds, Memphis's leading receiver. Field, which was a 33-yard completion to Frazier, stands. Not enough evidence to overturn the ruling on the field. Nothing indisputable, but a very nice ballet act on the throw by Lynch to Frazier on the sidelines to try to keep a foot inbounds and have possession of the football. Take a look at this. This is synced up here. And a fantastic job by our crew, led by Brian Boyle and Bob Frattaroli. You see the left foot and the right foot both tiptoeing the sideline inbounds on the right side shot. On the left side, it looks like Frazier was inbounds. And whether he was inbounds or not, there is not enough evidence to overturn the ruling on the field. And either way, excellent work by those feet of Frazier to have it ruled as a catch.
Yeah, I think the key is right there. I think Frazier keeps his heel off the ground when that left foot touches, and you can see right there he has the possession as well.
Fabulous work by our production truck here in Memphis to show you that shot. It's the shot that Jack Kramer got as well, and he kept it on the field. The call stands. So it's first down for Memphis. On the end around, trying to work across the 35-yard line, Roderick Proctor. They use a lot of these receivers in the run game as well. And a lot of weapons for Lynch.
And it's a run-first offense, but they like to run first to the edges. And they not only do that with their wide receivers and running backs, but their quarterback can get there also.
Lynch swinging it out on the comeback route. Here is Miller, cutting it all the way back to the middle of the field, and it'll set up third and about three here. Anthony Miller has the touchdown for Memphis in this game. They struck very quickly to start the night. Anthony Miller, their leading receiver in terms of yardage coming in. A former walk-on. There's about four or five guys on this Memphis wide receiving corps that were all walk-ons when they started their career. Third and three. Lynch fakes one, swings it out to Jamarius Henderson, and he's got the first down. What a great decision by Lynch, because if he threw it initially, that might have been batted or picked.
Yeah, Josiah Powell was actually coming from his linebacker position and might have just kept that one running to the end zone right there. You can see Powell, the pump fake, and then Lynch eventually gets the ball off and moves the chains.
Henderson again with a lead block from Gabe Kuhn. He takes a big hit from Mike Kelly, the linebacker, after picking up seven.
Jamarius Henderson is a very physical runner. The yards after contact, and he certainly likes to get downhill.
Part of that trip set. Lynch down the seam and too tall for Cross. It'll be third down and three. Couple of throws from Lynch, slightly off target. They've sailed on him a little bit so far.
Yeah, the same type of pass, kind of that touch pass down the seam where you have to drop it over the second level, but yet get it in there before a safety can break on it. And Lynch has been a little bit high about three times this evening.
We'll spread it out on third and short. Just a three-man rush for Navy. Lynch throws for the first down. Caught by Roderick Proctor as he works to the 38-yard line. Picks up 8 yards to move the chains.
The Navy plays a ton of zone coverage on the back end, and what they have to do is communicate and squeeze down those zones when they have a route in their area like they did right there. There was way too much room for the receiver to convert. That was too easy for Memphis.
Lynch swinging it out, and it was nearly picked by Quincy Adams. They've thrown that screen probably four or five times out to Anthony Miller, and Quincy Adams read it perfectly that time.
And Memphis's screen is the outside run game, and Quincy Adams breaks on it and becomes the receiver in a sense. But that's a case where a lot of times they're on the defensive side because they don't secure the ball that well.
A lot of veterans on this Navy defense. They've been there for a long time. That was a smart play by Adams, senior from Texas. Option to Henderson. And Adams is right there for the ankle tackle in open space to set up third and long.
The speed option getting Henderson to the edge, but I think the run game right now for Memphis is lacking Sam Kraft. He's more of the speed guy. The all-around back, he was a former receiver and kind of a hybrid receiver in the slot to a running back, and they miss his presence going to the edge. He's banged up. He's available tonight, but I don't believe we've seen him yet.
Haven't seen him out there for a snap. It's been Dorsius and Henderson mainly in the backfield with Lynch. Three-man rush again on third and eight, and the pressure gets to Lynch, who's going to tuck it and run it and get the first down. But penalty markers come flying in as Anthony Miller came charging in right at the end of that play. You saw a Navy defender kind of get taken out, and I wonder if Miller is going to get tagged for a flag here. And it was an unnecessary block in the back.
Absolutely.
He didn't have to do that because Lynch already had the first down.
Yeah, you're right. And it was Anthony Miller, number three, and it might have been on the other number three, Brandon Jones, the outside linebacker pursuing Paxton Lynch right there. But that's where you see the movement of Lynch. That's just all stuff that's off the grid of the play. And he avoided a sack and then gets out to his right.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Offense number 18, 15-yard penalty will be enforced from the end of the run. Third down.
So they will not tag Miller. They're going to get Proctor for unnecessary roughness, which seemingly was further away from the ball. Let's see if we can find 18. There's 18 right there, and he just takes out Daquan Thomason unnecessarily.
And it's the unnecessary roughness kind because Thomas wasn't involved in the play, so you can't just go headhunting, and you can see the penalties right there. Navy is very seldom penalized, and Memphis is penalized at a pretty good clip.
Only West Virginia averages more penalty yards per game. So it sets up 3rd and 14. Lynch over the middle and right at the sticks for Frazier. Did he have enough for the first down is the question now. It's going to be spotted about a yard and a half shy of the line to gain it. It's 4th down. And does Memphis go for it here? The offense seemingly is going to stay out on the field right now. They've been good on 4th down this season.
Look at this tight window once again. The dig route by Frazier sets down in that void, and then you see the arm strength, the high arm talent by Lynch, and he puts it right on the numbers.
They need a yard to convert. They'll try to keep it on the ground with Dorsius, and Brandon Jones comes up with a stop for Navy's defense. The sophomore out of Keller, Texas, with some help from that Navy front to stop it up. And Jones finished it off.
And Memphis was going with an unbalanced line, but Brandon Jones makes a huge play, and Navy gets off the field once again.
Brought to you by Chick-fil-A. We didn't invent the chicken, just the chicken sandwich. And Chevrolet. Find new roads.
The Cigar Box Guitar, made at St. Blues Guitar Workshop. They got three different lines, but the Cigar Box Guitar is about as unique as they come. All American made here in the great city of Memphis at the Liberty Bowl Memorial Stadium. Adam Amin, Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan. And a 10-7 lead for Memphis. This is to Brandon Sanders on the first play of a Navy drive, taking it out across the 40, out at the 44-yard line.
The triple option once again. You fake the fullback, and he gets a keep reading in a feathery pitch outside. And then look at the block by number 25, Brown, out on the edge. That's precision of the triple option, and that's the core of what Navy wants to do.
That was their longest play of the game, 15 yards on that run. 23 snaps, 22 rushes. Another flip. Come on, Brown, and he's close to the sticks. Again, the Memphis defense trying to bottle up Keenan Reynolds. You almost have to make a decision on who you're going to stop in this offense.
Yeah, and I think you want to stop number 19, Reynolds. There isn't any doubt about that. And I thought a really good adjustment to the speed of the game in which this triple option comes on to Memphis. I think that second drive, Memphis's defense looked pretty good.
The last two drives, Reynolds hasn't had much going.
The start of this drive, however, has been a different story. Getting to the edge has Navy.
Right back up the middle for Swain. Picks up decent first down yardage. Again, on the edges or up the middle. That's what you see.
It's two options.
It's two options on the edge or the option up the middle. And, I mean, Galen Scott told us about it yesterday. You almost got to force him to the inside. You got to force him to the outside. You got to make decisions quickly in this defense against Navy's triple out.
And it's hard to make decisions more quickly than Keenan Reynolds does.
Absolutely. One of the best decision makers to ever run this offense.
He loves this game at the line of scrimmage.
2nd down 5. It's a give to Quentin Ezell, the fullback. He's close to the marker. Brought down by McManus.
So, Adam, that's what you have. You have the establishment of the fullback in the middle. And if Keenan Reynolds gets a keeper, then he goes and attacks the next defender on the edge, and then it's whether he keeps it and gets down the alley or pitches it to the outside.
They've been good on third down all year. They've been good on third down tonight. And more often than not, in third and short. Reynolds keeps, now pitches, first down and more. Down the sideline, it's Tony O'Gully, and he got chopped down by McManus inside the red zone.
And third and one, certainly the defense is thinking fullback up the middle, and this is where Reynolds gets to you. He pulls it quickly, very decisive, and then gets it to the edge to go it. That's where this offense is so tough. You have to focus on the fullback because you really can't go anywhere from there defensively. But as soon as you do that, this quarterback will make you pay out on the edges.
That was the longest run of Gully's career. 31 yards, the longest run of the day for Navy. First and goal, Reynolds at 77 career rushing touchdowns. There goes Keenan Reynolds. And Reynolds gets stacked up at the two-yard line. Trying to get the push from Swain, but Sharif White was the first man there, along with Ricky Hunter, the veteran in his 46th career game, to stop up Keenan Reynolds. Second down and goal. Again, Reynolds comes into tonight close to a record. His family is here, 77 career rushing touchdowns, and I think there's some concern right now because Reynolds was slow moving off the field.
Yeah, he's definitely favoring that right side right there, that right arm, right shoulder. Took a big hit on that play, and you can get a sense that Memphis does not want this record set on them.
There's only been one game for Reynolds this year where he did not score a rushing touchdown. That was in the win over Air Force.
I think it was Sharif White that puts the wood to him right there. Actually, it might have been Deshaun Terry, the strong safety, number 32. But you just get the sense that Memphis certainly has some pride defensively and does not want any type of record set on them.
Sure. Reynolds is going to come back out of the field for a second down and goal from the three.
Unless Navy uses a timeout, then Reynolds has to come off the field.
Yeah, he had to come off the field. If you're an injured player, you have to sit out for at least a snap. And that is the case. So Tago Smith, who's making his 16th career appearance in a football game for Navy. Coaching staff says he's always ready to go. He's got to be ready now. The junior out of Georgia will man the triple option. And it's a give to Swain, and he walks right in for a Navy touchdown, and the Mids have taken the lead, their first of the night.
And Adam, what Navy did is they went unbalanced. They flipped one of their offensive linemen from the left side to the right side, and then they give it to a 245-pound fullback, and they just dare the defense to have enough gumption to stop them, and they couldn't right there.
Grevy makes it a four-point Navy lead. No Keenan Reynolds on the field for a snap, no problem. Just give it to the 245-pounder from Macon, Georgia. His second of the night. So Chris Cotter is going to have an update for us in a second, but if you're watching this game and you want to watch another game too, get your tablet, get your phone, get your laptop, watch ESPN app or watch ESPN.com. Michigan State on the road, unbeaten, taking on Nebraska. Number 15, Oklahoma in action right now. Number 3, Ohio State's got Minnesota coming up later on tonight. We've got an unbeaten and ranked team tonight in Memphis, but Chris Swain has given the Mids a four-point lead with his second rushing touchdown in the first half. Oglesby with a returnable kick from the three-yard line. The freshman gets pounded down at the 21. Ball comes out loose, and it's recovered by Memphis at the 18. Dangerous play there, but grabbed and corralled by Phil Mayhew. And we'll check in with Chris Cotter.
All right, Adam, Outback Halftime Report coming your way in just a few minutes. It's Separation Saturday, several games this afternoon and this evening having an impact on the playoff rankings. We'll go through them. Also, we're going to talk a little about the overtime game in Oxford. Crazy between Arkansas and Ole Miss. Plus, no huddle. That's rapid-fire highlights. It's coming your way, Outback Halftime Report. See you then.
Yeah, sounds good, Chris. We'll see in a few minutes. Excited to see what's gone on so far today. It's been an exciting one. In college football, Ole Miss gets upset by Arkansas. Florida nearly got upset, but they're headed to the SEC title game. Houston with a win to remain unbeaten. Oklahoma State with a win to remain unbeaten, knocking down TCU. Here is Moes Frazier on the end around. Love to use him in multiple facets, does this Memphis offense. And he'll pick up 4 yards on first down.
And Memphis has certainly been probing to the edges, mainly with their slot receivers in that fly sweep type of action. But you wonder when they're going to go vertical, probably sooner than later.
Boy, low throw by Paxton Lynch. He put his receiver, Frazier, into a terrible spot there. That's a rare, rare sight to see from Lynch on short yardage
and
throws.
This hasn't been the sharpest of games for Paxton Lynch. Usually he's very accurate because his feet are so good that typically he gets on the right platform and throws on time and on target, and that was not a good example of it.
And end up losing yardage on that play, and it's third and eight. Three-man rush gets to Lynch. Being chased, running out of room, throwing down the sidelines, and it is caught for a first down by Tevin Jones.
This will be coveted at the next level when a big quarterback, 6'7", almost 250, can get out of trouble and then throw on target to convert and move the chains. That will earn him a lot of money somewhere.
Screen, Mayhew slips a tackle with a Henderson block. And then gets run down by Will Anthony, the excellent defensive end for Navy's front seven. A 4-yard pickup there, and it's second down. Will Anthony making his 22nd consecutive start. Memphis trying to go a little bit faster. And Lynch will airmail one. The closest man to it was Mayhew, so no grounding. And it's third down and seven.
And remember what the MO is for Navy defensively, is they want to build clutter on the back end. And that was a good example of it. Just no receiver was open. Lynch has to throw it away. But just as much as Navy's offense wants to possess the football and control the clock, Navy's defense doesn't want to give up big plays. They want the opposing offense to have to be efficient and drive the football to get points.
Lynch has been good on third down tonight. And that ball was short. Looking for Tevin Jones on the outside. And this has not been prototypical Paxton Lynch through the first half of this game. Fourth down.
A little out of sync. The receiver, Jones, was not even slightly coming out of that. And then it was much deeper than the quarterback anticipated. Something was wrong between quarterback and receiver on that play.
Spencer Smith is the deep ball punter. Bangs it off the side of his foot, and it will die inside the 35-yard line. So Navy will have the football plus two timeouts in a minute 21 to go. We'll get you ready for week 9 of the NFL season. First at 10 o'clock Eastern on Sunday, NFL Insiders, week 9 news, early breaking stories, then Sunday NFL countdown. Remember, Peyton Manning is making his return to Indianapolis, where it turns out his impact runs a little bit deeper than just his play. He's going to get a chance, and you are too, to meet the dozens of high school players named Peyton in the state of Indiana. Sunday NFL countdown following NFL Insiders. Here is Reynolds. He has not gotten a ton going on the ground personally just yet. And he gets hit hard by Chris Morley after a 6-yard run. Let's see what Navy can do in what is essentially a 2-minute drill. A couple of timeouts and 60 seconds to play with. And it's a give to DeBrandon Sanders. And he works into Memphis territory at the 49-yard line.
Well, Navy isn't going to make a living out of throwing the football. We know that. That was the 32nd play and 31 runs. Only one pass, and it was a short screen pass.
Pitch, Sanders. And Sanders will get out of bounds to stop the clock, so they don't have to use one of those two timeouts. 44 seconds to play. They have a very, very good kicker in Austin Grebe. a senior who has only missed one field goal in his career. That was earlier this season against Notre Dame. And he's got a pretty decent leg on him. So if you get to about the 20-yard line or so, Grebe's going to have a pretty decent chance. Inside give Gully. Stacked up, grabbed from behind by Jannard Avery. 38 seconds and a timeout here for Navy.
The way Navy manages the clock in this situation isn't by throwing the football. They just go more quickly, and their pass to the sideline is essentially a pitch to their back to the sideline, and then he gets out of bounds like they did two plays ago.
On the season, Grebe is 9 of 10. His season long is 40. That came against Notre Dame. His career long is 45. That came against Army a year ago. Took over for Nick Sloan about midway through last season and has gone 15 of 16 since. Dad Joe served 28 years in the Army. And Austin Grebe could have a chance at a field goal to extend this Navy lead for Ken Niumatalolo, the head coach in his eighth season.
And there is a decent breeze that he would be kicking into if indeed they get to that point where letting him try a field goal attempt.
Third down and five. This is a pitch. This is Damon Brown, and he gets run out of bounds. Arthur Mollett, backup cornerback, was able to shove him out of bounds. It's going to be fourth down, and they're pretty much out of his range right now. 34 seconds. Do you go for it here? You're in plus territory inside the 45.
And we can see the punt team coming on, but that surprises me. I really thought that Navy would go for it right there. Fourth and three, you have 34 seconds left, and you need to try to get into field goal range. This is playing it fairly conservatively, a team that likes to go for it on fourth and makeable.
So Barta is out there to punt. They do have a timeout. We won't need it. Barta will try to keep this one in play. Man, he got it close to the sideline, but it ended up bounding into the end zone. So it's a net punt of 23. Good effort by Barta to get it close, but not enough.
And I love his directional kicking. That's about the second, I think the second time where he's knifed it off into that corner. That last punt decision by the head coach, Niumatalolo, might have been out of respect of Paxton Lynch, quite frankly. I think that's what we saw right there. They like where they are positioned. They can go into halftime right here, potentially with a four-point lead on an explosive offense and an NFL-type quarterback. I think Navy feels pretty good about themselves.
24 passes in the first half for Paxton Lynch, closing in on 200 yards already. And some surprising inaccuracy at times from Lynch tonight. Lynch over the middle, and it's just the second interception he's thrown this year. Daniel Gonzalez with his fourth career pick. You want to talk about un-Paxton Lynch-like tonight? That's about as rare as it gets, an interception.
Uncharacteristic greed right here. Gonzalez is just dropping into his zone and reading the quarterback's eyes, and that ball shouldn't have been thrown, needless to say, but those are decisions that we haven't seen Paxton Lynch make many times this year. His only interception before that one was in the Ole Miss game, and it was actually bounced off the chest of his receiver before it was picked off.
And Navy, with 17 seconds and a timeout, is essentially in field goal range for Grebe. Keenan Reynolds, his second pass of the night to the end zone, and it's dropped by Thomas Wilson. Wilson has had trouble in practice grabbing balls. This coaching staff has told Reynolds to try to trust Wilson a little bit, but that's a catch he has to make.
Right in his breadbasket, and Wilson slips down the seam from a tight slot position on the opposite side of the quarterback that time, and Reynolds put it on him, and Wilson could not finish.
They can still run it. They have one timeout, but they're going to pass again. Reynolds under pressure, flinging it off his back foot, a dangerous one to the 10, and it's incomplete with Calvin Cash Jr. in the area with a couple of defenders around him. Now again, Navy has a very good kicker, and indeed Austin Grebe will get a shot. to try to drill a long field goal.
We'll have to dial back to that missed opportunity, the drop by Thomas Wilson in the second half. This is probably going to come down to the fourth quarter, and that was a huge missed opportunity by Navy.
Grebe into the win from 44 to make it a seven-point lead. And Austin Grebe with a flag down drills the field goal to make it a seven-point game, but we have to check the penalty marker here. Ken Niumatalolo is already sprinting off the field, but there could be a running into the kicker situation here.
I don't think you take points off the board regardless of what this penalty is. I think they'll keep the field goal up there. You don't have any time left anyway.
Yeah, you'd have one untimed down to run a play here, and it would probably be to the end zone. You don't want that.
Personal foul, roughing the kicker. Defense number 45. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the second half kickoff. The field goal is good, and that's the end of the second quarter.
So Navy takes a seven-point lead into the halftime break. We'll hear from Justin Fuente during our halftime report. Chris Cotter, Robert Smith, Brett McMurphy in the studio. Outback Steakhouse halftime. Boys, it is all yours. This is the American Conference on ESPN. It's been one of the most exciting conferences in college football. Two teams in this conference currently unbeaten, including number 13, Memphis, which again, as it oftentimes has this season, during its 8-0 run, trailing at the halftime, and Navy putting it to the Tigers in that opening half, first meeting all time. Adam Amin, Kelly Stauffer, Olivia Harlan as well. When you have two styles, two differing styles in a game, it feels like the old cliche really fits. Who's going to impose their will on the other team? Navy kind of did so in that first 30.
I think Navy's very, very happy the way the first half played out. They same number of plays, but the time of possession, which Navy sure loves to control that part of it, they did that. And I think they are very happy with Navy's defense as well, because this clutter, the structure they create, and for Paxton Lynch to have to throw the football in, he hasn't seemed comfortable in that first half. At least he didn't.
Let's start with triple option at one side of the spectrum offensively. That's Navy's triple option. It starts on the inside. You got to establish the fullback.
Yeah, first. You establish the big guy swaying in the middle at 245 pounds, and then you expand it to the edges. And that's exactly what Keenan Riddle does at the line of scrimmage. He gets his team typically in exactly the right play. And we talked about Paxton Lynch. He started out hot. That first drive was very impressive. Didn't take very long to get in the end zone. But then it was a lot of this kind of stuff. His second interception of the year, but there were other passes where he just wasn't in rhythm. And it wasn't just because of the lack of opportunities, although that was part of it. And that's exactly what Navy intends to do. But it was also the structure that Navy defensively plays with. They force the quarterback to have to throw into tight windows, and the quarterback, Paxton Lynch, has to be patient here in the second half.
Lynch threw his second interception of the season in that first half, late in the second quarter. You see total plays. Each team has 37 plays on the game, but Navy had the ball for nearly 18 and a half minutes. Lynch struggled after that very impressive opening drive. And Navy will get the ball to start half number two. Another very good kick by Jake Elliott. Now to the 25 comes Navy. And down to the field we go to Olivia.
Yeah, guys, you heard Justin Fuente tell me at half that Paxton Lynch tried to squeeze one in there with that pick. But with that pick, Navy's defense now has had a takeaway in 15 straight games. Defensive coordinator Dale Pearson told me to have a chance in this game, he thought they'd need three tonight. Well, that's one. Coach Niumatalolo says they're playing exactly how they want to on offense. And just five passing yards, that's par for the course. That's who Navy is. Says they may not throw it again all night.
Yeah, 194 rushing yards is par for the course, too, for Navy, Olivia. Good stuff. First down from the 25. Reynolds takes a beating on that pitch, but it's a good decision as Sanders has it out across the 35-yard line. 14 yards in the first play of the half.
Reynolds is so decisive. No fullback. Get pressured on the edge. He gets dumped on his head, but he does make a nice pitch. The triple option, and Navy says this. The more we can run the triple, the better we're going to be, and they start off with a really good one right there.
First down from the 39-yard line. Reynolds keeps, and this time he's going to get dragged down. Good assignment football by Regis Ball. safety out there and a loss of 2 yards on the play. You know, it's interesting, Kelly. I think the officials may have forgotten to assess the
penalty.
That's
what I was wondering, exactly.
We saw the ball spotted at the 35. Remember the penalty at the end of the half? They declined, or they opted to keep the field goal, I should say, but the penalty was supposed to be enforced on the kick. I wonder if the officials forgot about that. Reynolds will throw. This is fourth pass of the night. This time it's short. And it's grabbed by Brandon Cologne. His fourth career catch and first of the season. Picks up 6 yards, and it's third down.
And third and a little bit longer than what Navy is comfortable with. And so this is a good opportunity for Memphis to get off the field. Navy loves to take, they defer if they win the toss. They love to go on a methodical drive to start the second half. It'll be important for Memphis to make a play right here. We like to start imposing that will early here in the second half, Adam.
It'll be a give up the middle to Swain. He got grabbed by two Tigers, including Jannard Avery. It would be fourth down and about four here, maybe a little too long for Ken Niumatalolo's taste to go for it on fourth down in this field position. And indeed, Alex Barta, who's been very good tonight, although the last punt was net 23, tried to pin it to the sideline. He's been good, though. Miller is back to return. Barta with a line drive. And it takes a bounce inside the 20. It'll be a 39-yard punt. So Memphis offensively had that great opening drive. Paxton Lynch was 4-for-4 on that series, where Memphis jumped out to a 7-0 lead. But since then, he kind of struggled, did throw a pick late in the first half, and just some surprising inaccuracy at times.
Yeah, and at times he just seemed uncomfortable trying to throw into that zone defense on the back end. The Navy's doing a really good job in the back seven of squeezing down zones and creating tight windows. I think Lynch is very comfortable throwing in the face of a blitz. He didn't look comfortable throwing in the face of structure in that first half.
They've been the best second half offense in college football this year. The Memphis Tigers averaged 24 points per second half this year. Dorsius with a good first down run of 6.
And this is a rhythm offense. They need to get in the flow here early in the second half.
Fake on the handoff. This is Miller. And he got grabbed by Clements. And spun away from Clements and got the first down. Anthony Miller showing off a little bit of strength in that 5'11 frame. Tempo comes with first downs. And when Miller and this Memphis offense get going with first downs, the tempo really starts to pick up. Something that's very difficult to contend with against this Navy D. Dorsius trying to bounce it to the outside, slips a tackle. First down for Dorsius, still on his feet. Additional yardage to the 42-yard line. Excellent run by the redshirt sophomore from New Orleans.
The Navy is typically pretty good up front at not only diagnosing things, but tackling well. And they miss a couple of tackles here. They have it defended really well. Dorsius then gets off to the left and bounces it. In the first half, Navy defended very well.
Longest run of the game, 15 yards. Lynch dumps it off for Frazier. And incomplete. And Micah Thomas with the pressure coming in on Lynch, forcing him out of the pocket. Second down.
And Adam, I think it's important to revisit who Navy is defensively. They're a zone team. They're a bend but don't break team. And they're kind of a mirror image of what they do offensively.
Sure.
They want to force efficiency. Their offense possesses it, limits the touches an offense is going to have of the opposition, and their defense then defends well. And they did it really well in the first half.
Here's Dorsius. Got grabbed at the ankles by Daniel Gonzalez. The third down and 5 here. Memphis offensively, very solid, as we told you. They can get going in a heartbeat, and they've had to do it a lot this year. They've had 5 comeback wins when they've trailed by at least double digits, and 3 wins when they've been trailing at halftime this year. This is not uncharted territory for Justin Fuente. and five. Swinging to the outside. Frazier breaking a tackle, and he got popped a yard shy of the line to gain by Laurentez Barber. It's going to depend on the spot, and it looks to be just short. What a hit.
This is going to be interesting. In the end, you're going to see that kind of the bubble outside and then the hit by Barber. It comes up just a little bit short, and it appears that Memphis is going to stay on the field and go for it right here.
Hard-hitting senior from Louisville forces fourth and about a half a yard for Lynch. Third time they've gone for it on fourth down, and Lynch will fake the handoff, keep it himself, and has the first down.
A lot of window dressing, and they bring a slot receiver. They motion him back into the backfield. There's Anthony Miller, and then in the end, they fake it to him, and the 6'7", 245-pound quarterback converts and moves the chains.
This is the freshman Henderson stumbling his way into the body of DJ Palmore. Picks up 5 yards, second down. Henderson, true freshman out of Alabama.
We just haven't seen a lot of the downfield vertical passing game at all out of Lynch. You just think they're going to get to that sooner than later. But again, Navy's structure, their zones on the back end have made that very difficult.
Henderson again, seeking space. Not much room there. Thomas came in to help finish it off, but Palmore back-to-back plays on this series. This time it'll be third down and four, 10th play of this drive after Memphis got off the field defensively.
The Navy's defense once again forcing Lynch and company from Memphis to be efficient. Here they are, third and four, and they have to convert again in order to extend this drive.
Four-man Navy rush. Gets to Lynch, who takes off and has a first down on the ground again. Gonzalez chopped him, but not before he got to the 34.
The extension of a play by a quarterback that has such natural, instinctive movement in the pocket. Convert and move the chains once again.
NFL scouts really love this guy right now. He's been a hot name in terms of quarterbacks. Gives to Miller on the end around. Miller lost the football. It was loose at the 24-yard line. Quincy Adams punched it out of the hands of Miller, but it will stay with Memphis.
We talked about Memphis being a run-first team, and their running backs are more of the downhill in the box guys, and then Anthony Miller, the slot receiver from that jet sweep, and he definitely puts that on the ground, and I think it bounced right back to him.
It didn't go too far away, and lucky for Miller as he has the first down. Zone read to Henderson. Over the middle for a first down to the 10-yard line. Phil Mayhew spinning to the nine, and it's first down and goal for Memphis. 15-yard play there.
Well, Adam, you were wondering when this was coming, kind of the zone read, and then you throw a strike behind that second level of defenders that are coming up for the running back. We saw it right there.
On the ground, Henderson swallowed up. Good play by Will Anthony. These are two of the best, and I mean best, red zone offenses in college football. Very rarely have these teams gotten inside the 20 and not scored. And more often than not, both teams have scored touchdowns when they get inside the 20. A red zone defensive stand for either team is huge. Lynch still on his feet, and it'll be third down and goal at the 1 yard line coming up. And a penalty marker comes flying in late. And the way Memphis is reacting, it looked like it could be a Navy penalty. Lynch a little bit slow as he works to the sideline.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Defense number three. First down.
Brandon Jones got called for it. Now, the problem isn't necessarily the yardage on the penalty because it's half the distance. Now, it's four turns for maybe Memphis to get into the end zone.
And this is well after the play. You'll see number three, Brandon Jones, right there. They kind of get tangled up, and it was maybe more of an acting job than anything else, but Jones gets called for the penalty nonetheless.
A rare Navy penalty, and it's first and goal Memphis with a chance to get a touchdown to tie the game. Here is Miller into the end zone. Touchdown, Memphis. Memphis has been trying to avoid slow starts coming out of the locker room, whether it's to open the game or to open the second half. Tonight, both opening drives have been very long and very impressive, and both have led to scores.
Well, and Navy wants to take the opening drive and go on that long, methodical drive, and Memphis's defense got off the field and gave it to their offense, who took full advantage of it, marched it right down. That was an important sequence in this game.
And Anthony Miller, with Sam Kraft injured, banged up, not really getting the touches as that hybrid player, this is back-to-back weeks that Anthony Miller has a rushing touchdown, and we're tied. Paxton Lynch's name has been thrown out there at times for the Heisman Trophy candidacy, and why not? He's been very impressive most of the year. Been an un-Paxton Lynch-like night tonight, but Anthony Miller's got two scores, one through the air and one on the ground. And he has tied this game at 17 apiece. Memphis getting it done on the ground on that last drive. Another good kick by Elliott. Three out of every four of his kicks have been touchbacks this season. Last drive, Memphis getting it done. Long drive.
Memphis has had six possessions, three drives of 12 plays or more. They've been able to possess it once in a while and be efficient, but it's the quarterback run game and then this pass right here. We saw the play action fake in the backfield, and then they pay it off. A very good block by there by Ellen Cross, their tight end that time, but Navy's offense is going to absolutely force Memphis's offense to be efficient tonight. That's the name of this game, and that was a good sign for Memphis starting the second half.
Navy back to work. Reynolds with his fifth pass of the night, and a deep shot. Open man to Brandon Sanders. Navy answers and takes the lead. That's just Reynolds' third touchdown pass of the season. But when Navy gets a look through the air, man, do they make them count. And DeBrandon Sanders really makes them count.
DeBrandon Sanders is one of those slot backs that's been cutting a safety to the ground all the first half. And this time they come and play action pass and find him down the seam.
That was the longest pass of Keenan Reynolds' career. His third touchdown pass of the season, but DeBrandon Sanders did most of the work here, blocking all night long, and this time he breaks free, averaging over 20 yards a catch in his career. He gives Navy the lead.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Zales. Declare your diamond kind of love with gorgeous gifts from Zales, the diamond store. And Pennzoil Synthetics. Make the switch to Pennzoil Synthetics today.
Memphis Tiger basketball team played at FedEx Forum in their exhibition last night. The Grizzlies are out of town right now. They're on their West Coast swing. They're in Utah tonight. And there is Tom the Tiger, much more active in the pregame. He has taken a much-needed rest for the time being in his digs right now. Both teams with interesting touchdown drives here in the second half, and it's a 7-point Navy lead. Grebe, a short kick, and this is Anthony Miller. And Miller's got a seam, staying on his feet, and there goes Miller. Chopped down by Grebe as he got close to midfield. Looks all the way to the 48 of Navy. A 47-yard return from Miller. Let's go back to that touchdown, that interesting touchdown from Navy.
Well, DeBrandon Sanders is right here, and typically he goes and blocks the defender responsible for the pitch. And just when you forget about that, he slips by you and runs a wheel route. Navy does this so well, and it's so hard on the defensive backfield because, remember, Sanders is coming block those guys to the ground multiple times in the first half, and that time he just goes by him on the wheel route.
Excellent field position for Lynch. Paxton Lynch deep down the field. First down and more. Roderick Proctor to the 21-yard line. 27 yards.
And you wondered when the vertical game was going to start to show up, and here you see it off the play action. And Roderick Proctor goes to the corner. And just as Navy's offense expands from the inside out, Memphis goes deep that time.
Another play fake. Lynch over the top for Cross, and too tall and incomplete. Cross does not have a catch tonight, but he's been a target that Lynch likes to go to as often as possible. First team American Conference tight end a season ago, and a veteran playing in his 45th career game.
And Cross got kind of turned around on that play, but a lot of the vertical passing game for Memphis is going to come off their play action pass game.
Second down 10. This time it's a give to Jarvis Cooper, his first carry of the night. The sophomore gets tagged for a loss by Bernard Serra and Micah Thomas. Third down and 11 here.
And Adam, we saw Ellen Cross, the tight end, a couple of plays ago, and this is typically where number 40 shows up.
Yeah.
Deep in the red zone off a play action pass. You probably won't see play action off a third and 11, but keep an eye on that guy right there.
Lined up in the left slot. Lynch stepping up against the pressure. He's going to get hit from behind as he releases the ball to the end zone, and it is incomplete. Lynch took a shot from the backside as he was starting to get that arm release going. Fired it to Frazier, who could not corral.
Once again, the good movement by Lynch. But Navy defensively does not stop. Amos Mason that particular time from his defensive end position just ends up forcing an errant throw by hustling and getting Lynch from the backside.
Again, another three-man rush that forces Lynch out of the pocket. Elliott from 38, he's been good from 40 tonight. And Elliott, again, is good. Memphis gets points. A rare trip to the red zone without a touchdown, but it's a four-point game in the third. These are the nine remaining unbeaten teams. TCU was beat by Oklahoma State earlier today, along with the win-out percentage, counting conference championship games for those teams and conferences that have won, including Houston and Memphis here in the American Conference. This will be the first year of an American Conference title game. We'll get you an update on a couple of those unbeaten teams. Ohio State hosting Minnesota tonight. LSU, of course, is on the road, taking on Alabama in a huge SEC West showdown. Elliott, another touchback. Off to Chris Cotter in the studio. What you got, brother?
Yeah.
All right, here's what we got. You talked about the unbeaten teams. Let's start with LSU taking on Alabama. Derrick Henry is going to score here. These two tailbacks bruising each other right now, but Alabama on top, 10-0. Meanwhile, on ABC, Ohio State can't get anything going offensively, so they rely on their defense. Von Bell picks off Mitch Leidner. He takes it to the house. Just 7-0 Buckeyes right now over on ABC. About 4 minutes left to go first half.
Ohio State offense is just completely different animal without JT Barrett pulling the trigger.
Under the suspension for this game after the incident last week involved him operating a vehicle under the influence. So a suspension for this week as Ohio State tries to remain unbeaten. Reynolds keeping it, and on first down he runs for about five, running into Sharif White. Keenan Reynolds, senior out of Antioch, Tennessee, as we told you, he is in his home state about 220 miles away from where he grew up. One of 15 on the Navy roster from the state of Tennessee. Started playing football at 5 years old. Olivia told you he's always been the quarterback. His dad, Donnie, was his first head coach. Only had a couple of offers to play Division I football, only a couple of FBS offers. keeps it again. Pitch to the side. This is Damon Brown, and he's got the first down. More on Keenan with Olivia.
Guys, I was standing right by Keenan ever since he came off the field after the last drive, and he hardly said a word to anyone. He was just focused on warming up, holding hand warmers, very focused on that. And he did tell us this week that he's gotten a lot better at dealing with the ups and downs throughout a game, and his big focus, not letting his teammates see when he is down. You know, there's one thing on his mind tonight, and it's rushing for a touchdown. Whether he says it or not, you know that's on Navy's mind.
First down 10. Misdirection for Reynolds, who got dragged down before he could make a quick decision. However, it may be a face mask penalty against Michael Edwards. Looked like his hand may have gone a little bit further up than he wanted to.
Personal foul. Face mask. Defense number 95. 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
Indeed, it was a face mask against Michael Edwards.
Edwards makes a nice play, gets penetration on the defensive line, then he has the quarterback, fights off the block, and just reaches right there with his right hand. That's unfortunate because that's a really nice play by 95 Edwards.
Again, Memphis is one of the most penalized teams in college football. That's just the third accepted penalty against them for 40 yards tonight, but it comes at a crucial time. And it sets up Navy inside of Memphis territory. Straight up the gut, there goes Ezell. And a really good first down run. Second down. Well, don't forget Monday Night Football coming your way. And two teams that have lost a bunch of games by one score. Bears come in at 2-5. Chargers are 2-6. Yet both teams are coming on 3-point losses. They're desperate for a win. Out west, it'll be Monday Night Football, Bears and Chargers. Phillip Rivers, former North Carolina State Wolfpack QB. Big run, Chris Swain, into the open field, and it's another rushing touchdown for Navy. And don't look now, but Memphis is down double digits again. The Navy rushing attack doing the work tonight in Tennessee.
And when Keenan Reynolds gets this offense to the edges, the defense a lot of times gets their eyes in the wrong place and they forget about the fullback. And that's exactly what Navy made him pay for right there with Chris Swain, 245 pounds, rumbling into the end zone.
If you haven't seen the triple option, if you haven't seen Navy play football this year, the fullback does the damage. Chris Swain, who had 5 touchdowns on the season coming in, has rumbled for 3 of them tonight, and Memphis down double digits again. Memphis is one of 9 remaining unbeaten teams, and they have 5 wins out of the 8-0 record that they have this year. 5 wins when trailing by double digits this season. You see that bottom line? Most since 2000 in college football. That year, North Carolina State had 6 wins of double-digit comeback variety. And Phillip Rivers, who you'll see on Monday Night Football for the Chargers, he was the freshman quarterback that year for the 8-4 North Carolina State Wolfpack. But it's an 11-point lead, the first double-digit lead of the night tonight.
You want to be good at coming back, but you don't want to get comfortable with always digging yourself in a hole, right?
Yeah. And Memphis has done it far too often for Justin Fuentes Tate. They got off to a good start. Remember, they led 7-0 in this game, but Navy has done what they seemingly do to a lot of teams and just wear them down.
Yeah, and that's the difference in this game, dude. Memphis doesn't have an unlimited amount of touches when you play a Navy team the way Navy plays offensive football.
It's not like the Tulsa game where they had more than 700 yards because they're going to get it back over and over again. Here is Miller from the 3, trying to get something explosive going for Memphis. And he works out to the 30-yard line, pretty decent return. But so far in the Navy offense, Chris Swain's been the star, 3 touchdowns.
Yeah, he's certainly the touchdown maker and the drive finisher, but he's the heart and soul of what this offense is about. Keenan Reynolds gets him in the right place, and if you forget about that guy, that position in general, the fullback position and the triple option, they will gash you time and time again, and just when you forget about it, they'll make you pay.
The Chick-fil-A impact player tracker has Swain going for 8 yards a pop tonight and his first career 3-touchdown game. Jarvis Cooper on first down, picks up four, and there's an injured mid down on the field. 3 minutes to play here in the third. While we have a moment, let's step aside. Chris Cotter's got an update.
Adam, let's go to the Big Ten, where Michigan State trailing Nebraska, but here comes Connor Cook. His favorite target is Aaron Burbridge. Burbridge is going to split the defense and score right here. So Michigan State goes on top, 24-20. Nebraska was driving just through a pick. How about LSU and Alabama? 10-0 Bama. Trayvon Dural, that was going to hand it, take this one and score. So LSU back in it, 10-7 right now.
Yeah, Chris, thanks very much. Again, a couple of unbeaten teams in action tonight. LSU and Michigan State both on the road this evening. Second down, six coming up. It was Amos Mason who was a little bit shaken up on the play. He's off the field. Lynch, back shoulder throw and a twisting catch by Phil Mayhew. And then he coughed up the football and Adams is there to recover it for Navy. And another Memphis turnover after a great catch by Phil Mayhew, but he could not hold on to the football. But Lynch is still on the field.
I don't really know what the question is. Phil Mayhew certainly seemed to cough that one up. Catches the ball in the seam, but that's another benefit of Nafy playing in zone defense. They break out of zones and get to that football, and then they're ripping at it with multiple players around the ball.
Ted Colburn was the one who forced the fumble. You saw the Memphis offense wait an additional moment on the field. The call on the field was a fumble recovered by Navy, and now Adam Savoy is going to head over to the headset, and Jack Kramer, the replay official, is going to check this out. Likely they're going to check whether the knee was down for Mayhew or not after he had made that catch.
And we've talked so much about Navy's defense building structure and clutter for Paxton Lynch to have to find windows in. But another benefit is guys are in their zone, they're watching the football, and you have multiple players break on the ball. Phil Mayhew catches it here. Look at the defenders ripping at it. Is that left knee down? You're exactly right.
That's the question. Was the left knee down while Mayhew was in possession of the ball, or was the ball coming out?
Indisputable video evidence. And remember, it was called, rightly so, a fumble on the field.
Yeah, you think it's going to be a fumble either way. They could confirm this potentially.
Left knee is getting close, right there.
Well, I don't know there.
Yeah, that's a pretty good look. The ball's not out, right?
Based on that, it didn't seem like the ball was out of the possession of Mayhew, and I think this may be enough. This may be considered indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. And if it is, man, is that a break for Memphis.
And the rule book actually adds beyond all doubt. Indisputable video evidence, but it's beyond all doubt. So it's always so important how it's called on the field, and officials are taught to let it play out and let it be a fumble, and you can always overturn it if need be.
But that's the point of the replay process. You still don't want to take everything out of the hands of the human element on the field, which are the officials that work so hard to try to make the right calls.
After review, ruling on the field stands.
Now, again, can you look at that replay and say, I think it was indisputable, or you think it was indisputable video evidence to overturn the call in the field? Maybe. But based on what the replay booth saw, they did not feel that it was indisputable video evidence. So they go with the call that was made on the field by the officials. Not conclusive, not indisputable. Although you can make a pretty good argument. At the very least, here is Swain. He's got three touchdowns tonight, and he picks up a yard.
Well, and most of the time, Adam, with the replay situation, if you and I are discussing it and we can't quite decide, that's exactly how
that's
it's determined on the field. That's the point. That's not indisputable video evidence. And so if you have a question at home, typically you're right, and they're not going to overturn it.
That's a good way to think about it. Second down, nine. Again, when Navy wins the turnover battle, 16-1 over their last four seasons. Reynolds will keep it. Wasn't much room to pitch on the short side of the field that time. Ran into a tough spot with Jameel Collins closing in.
It was somewhat of a bad angle because Quincy Adams came off the corner and got essentially between Reynolds and the pitch guy, because the pitch guy had some room out on the edge if Reynolds could have got him the football.
Does this Memphis defense have a stand on third and six, down 11?
They might have to have two stands, because if Navy doesn't get it here, this might be where they go for it on four.
It is Swain, chopped down at the 45. It would be about 4 yards to go on fourth down. And as we've told you plenty, and what the coaching staff told us, our job is to possess the ball. This is Ivan Jasper. That's Nia Matalolo. But Ivan Jasper, the coordinator, said, it's our job to possess it. That's why they go for it so much on fourth down. 13 of 15 on the season. They've got three timeouts with which to work. Reynolds checks the play again.
Trying to draw him off.
Yep.
It looks just like what he typically does going to the line of scrimmage. They sold it well, but a lot of quality discipline by Memphis.
They won't burn a timeout here. They strictly went out there to try to see if they could draw Memphis offsides for a free five and a fresh set of downs. Instead, they'll take the 5 yard penalty and punt.
And Alex Barta has been great at rocketing shots to the corner. We'll see if he can do it right here, because certainly Navy wants to take advantage of this field position and pin Paxton Lynch and company deep.
He's been a good directional kicker tonight, going towards the sideline, and it was grabbed by Miller. And Miller gets out of the end zone. And he is pinned at the 2 yard line. What a punt by Barta. And I don't know why Anthony Miller makes an over the shoulder end zone catch.
He shouldn't have. Completely wrong decision right here. This ball was into the end zone. Regardless of how much you want to make a play right here, you have to consider your offense doesn't want to inherit the ball on about the inside the 5 yard line. Poor decision by Anthony Miller.
And a fantastic punt by Barta, and great coverage by Navy.
Yeah, Barta didn't find the coffin corner, but Miller bailed him out and made a bad decision.
So another long field in front of Paxton Lynch, although twice they've gone over 80 yards for touchdowns tonight. Lynch rolling and throwing, and a diving attempt incomplete by Mose Frazier. This is a big drive and a big swinging series, I think, in the story of this game, because if Memphis doesn't end up with the yardage that they need to try to get a first down, you're looking at Navy with the ball at the start or early in the fourth quarter, trying to burn off a lot of clock with 11 points as their lead. Good run on second down by Dorsius. Close to the sticks, about a yard shy, and it'll be third and short when we start the fourth quarter. There are 9 teams without a loss in the FBS right now. Memphis is one of them. They've been trailing by double digits all year. They trail by 11. Navy hasn't beaten an AP-ranked team in 6 years. They're up through 3 with first place in the American West on the line. According to the Football Power Index, Memphis was a 77% favorite to win this game. They trail by 11 to the fourth. And Alan Cross, he of 45 career games, the redshirt senior out of Millington, Tennessee, which is not too far from Memphis, trying to rile up the troops. A big third and one to start the fourth quarter for the Tigers. And Paxton Lynch will keep it. And again, as he's done a couple of times tonight, pick up the first down to the 16-yard line. Amos Mason got him at the legs, but Lynch had long frame lunges for the first.
Well, that's been the addition to Memphis's run game in the second half. They got to the edges, remember, in that fly sweep stuff. And in the second half, Lynch has kept it and gone up in the tackle box.
In this direction for Dorsius off the left side. And Micah Thomas wraps him up at the 20 after a four-yard gain. What's at stake tonight? First place in the American Conference in the West Division. Houston won earlier tonight over Cincinnati, so they're 5-0. The winner of this game keeps pace and still has an edge going forward with a division title in mind. Lynch all day to the sideline, incomplete. At the 40 for Tevin Jones, 3rd and 6. Chris Cotter, what you got?
Some Big Ten action for you. Ohio State, we mentioned the offense struggling. Well, give it to Zeke. Ezekiel Elliott bounces it to the outside, finally getting something going before the end of the first half on ABC. It's a 14-0 Buckeye lead.
Tracy Clays in his second game as the interim head coach in this particular stint after Jerry Kill announced his retirement last week. Lynch on third down, incomplete, dropped by Dorsius out of the backfield. And he made that catch. He still may have been tackled short, but it's going to bring up fourth down, and likely the punt unit has to come on.
And Dorsius just comes out of the backfield, and actually that slot receiving position just sets down short of first down depth. But notice the ball placement on a running back. It was off his frame, and a lot of times tight ends, running backs do not adjust that well to the football.
Big punt for Spencer Smith, who leads the American in net average. Pinning it to the sideline for Calvin Cass. Navy of 11 looking to do what they do best, and that's move the clock. 14 to play. First American Conference title game will be on December the 5th at the home of the team with a better conference record among the East and West champions. Three teams right now unbeaten in the West. As a matter of fact, it's the only division in college football that has three unbeaten teams in conference play. Houston won earlier tonight. Memphis and Navy both coming in at 4-0. And Memphis, of course, has a lot more riding on it than just that. Both of these teams have hopes for a New Year's Six Bowl, but Memphis has an outside shot of the college football playoff. A loss tonight might end those hopes. Here is Swain. He gets bottled up, and it'll be a short game. Week 9 of the NFL season gets started on ESPN. First at 10 o'clock Eastern Time. It's NFL Insider Sunday Edition with all the news and early breaking stories. Then on Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by Snickers, Peyton Manning, as he returns to Indianapolis, you'll get to meet dozens of high school players named Peyton, along with their parents, as they discuss their favorite quarterback from his days in the state of Indiana, starting at 10 Eastern on ESPN. Second down, 9 for Navy. Swain, third down, and a big one coming up for the Memphis defense. Swain has been a rock star tonight. 3 rushing touchdowns for the first time in his career on a night that had Keenan Reynolds as the headliner, hoping for a rushing touchdown to break the all-time record. It's been Swain doing the damage. 3rd and 5. Toss play. Sanders, good block, and a first down. Damon Brown on the edge, as so many of the slot backs do, with a great block to open up an alley.
You have Brandon Sanders on the carry, and then Damon Brown, like you talked about, the other slot back gets out and gets a tremendous block, number 25. The arc release right there just gets square on the defender, and then there comes Sanders behind him. Quick pitch gets Navy quickly to the edge.
Time going to the right for Romine. And Romine turning the corner for a first down. Shoved out of bounds at the 36-yard line. 13 more Navy rushing yards.
Yeah, this is just a good play one way. Let's flip it and do it the other way. Once again, you see the block by goalie, number 22. And then Romine gets to the edge. And before long, you're going to see Swain again, rumbling up inside. The fullback will be established sooner than later.
Navy over 300 yards on the ground. A pitch to Gully. Gully shifting his way and takes a hit from Deshaun Terry after about a 4-yard run. About 2.5, probably, more accurately.
This is at actually Easel inside, Ezel, and look at all the attention, and guess what's outside? Room to run for the pitch. That's how this offense works. Whether the fullback gets it or not, he's essentially the epicenter of what the triple option is all about.
253-pound focal point will get the handoff here. A couple more yards and a makeable third down and four.
Third and four, clock is being chewed up. This is a drive-killing offense, and they don't have to wait for a drive-killing four-minute situation. They start to have drive killers at 12 minutes. Or clock killers, and that's what we're seeing right here.
Swain is in. Reynolds keeps. Pitches late. Damon Brown, another first down for Navy. They just grind and wear on you. That was the 52nd rush of the night by Navy.
Well, Galen Scott was afraid of this right here, the Memphis defensive coordinator. Fullback up inside, Keenan Reynolds, immaculate ball handling, and then he gets Romine to the edge, or excuse me, Damon Brown that particular time. Very difficult to defend when you have a surgeon like Reynolds running it from the quarterback position.
Toss play for Sanders. There's a cut block by Brown, and Sanders turns the corner, tiptoeing down the sidelines. Another first down.
So as Sanders going in motion to be the pitch guy in the triple option that direction, or are they going to pitch in the ball quickly and gain leverage outside? That time it was the latter, the quick pitch, and Sanders gets to the edge in a heartbeat.
How about those feet by Sanders to stay in bounds? Very deft movement in a tight territory along the sidelines. First and goal, and remember, Keenan Reynolds, who has not done a ton on the ground tonight rushing the ball, still has a chance to break the record for rushing touchdowns. Here is Cass. It'll be Cass into the end zone for a score, and Navy has taken a three-score lead in the fourth against unbeaten Memphis.
When a defense gets worn down and gets tired of this same look, fullback inside, pitch outside, they lose angles. There's a really good block outside by Gaston, Joey Gaston, number 65, but Memphis defensively are losing their gusto, and their angles defensively are falling off the edge of the earth.
10 to play, 18-point game, and this is the first career rushing touchdown for Calvin Cash, and it has given Navy a big lead on the road.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy, and Dunkin' Donuts. America runs on Dunkin'.
One of the bucket list places if you're a party animal, Beale Street here in Memphis, underrated gem. Had a great week here in Memphis, but Tom's not feeling it right now. And you can understand why. Memphis, with so much promise to reach heights they've never reached before, right now they're down by 18 with 10 minutes to play, and Navy trying to do something they haven't done in over three decades. That's beat a top 15 team ranked in the AP. Anthony Miller, can he get something going in a return game for Memphis? He's going to get hit shy of the 20 as we check in with Chris Cotter in the studio.
All right, Adam, Memphis is fighting for their lives, as are Michigan State right here. Connor Cook, his fourth touchdown pass of the night. He hits Jamal Lyles on this one. So you think the Spartans are going to start pulling away on the road, right? Wrong. Tommy Armstrong Jr. comes right back for Nebraska. Remember, he missed last week's game. Riker Fife was the quarterback last week. Armstrong puts his head down and gets into the end zone. It's a 5-point Spartan lead right now in the fourth.
Listen, I know Nebraska's had bad loss and tough loss and close loss and for close loss. Is there anything to make you believe that they can't pull an upset at home? Lynch over the middle on first down, caught by Dorsius, grabbed quickly by Goble, second down.
You just have a feeling right now that Memphis absolutely needs a touchdown here, right? I mean, they may not get the ball back.
Yeah.
The way Navy's offense is marching it, and Navy's defense has played so well. A team in Memphis that scores 48 points a game, and tonight, two touchdowns, two field goals. That's good stuff from a defense
tonight
that's
39. We'll start on my signal.
A defense that's overshadowed a lot of times by what their offense does.
Sure. Again, clock issue. I had to put 13 seconds back on the clock there. Swing it out to the side. This is Proctor. Proctor close to the sticks as he got grabbed by Brandon Jones from behind.
Navy's defense simply does not give up big plays, and they force efficiency out of the opposition. The offense that Memphis right now, they just haven't been consistently efficient tonight to get it done.
Running left, it's Dorsius. And he lost the football again, and it's Navy ball as Clemens dives on top of it. Memphis is falling apart right now, and Navy is in control.
You learn, lose the turnover takeaway to Navy, and you simply can't beat them. Dorsius puts the ball on the ground right here, and Clements jumps on top of it. I think it was Barber from his free safety position breaks it loose. Tough sledding right now in Memphis for the Tigers.
USC has won 11 of the last 13 against Arizona. You'll see that on ESPN. And then as soon as that's done, SportsCenter at night. Huge day. I'm talking a monster in college football, plus the NBA and NHL. We'll get you set to go for the weekend in the NFL as well. SportsCenter at night when Arizona-USC is done on ESPN. Here, one of the unbeatens is starting to fade. 18-point lead for Navy. Looking for an upset of an AP top 15 team. Memphis, the number 15 team in the AP poll for the first time since 1984. Here is Swain. And he works to the 40. 6 years ago to the day was the last time that the Navy midshipmen had a win over an AP-ranked top 25 team. Vince Murray had 158 yards on the ground in the upset against number 19 Notre Dame. And then you got to go back 31 years. Last time it was a win over a top 15 team, number 2 South Carolina went down. They had national title hopes that year, but the Navy upset derailed those. You got to go back a long way for a win of this magnitude for Navy. Swain again, first down, and still on his feet to the 26-yard line. He's putting together one special night on what could be a monumental night for the Navy football program.
And you notice the offense that Navy was running in those clips from 31 years ago, right?
Just about the same, I would say.
Their fullback wasn't nearly as big as Chris Swain, but the desire was the same. The concept was the same, and this is a difficult out this time of the year. This game, this triple option where offensive players are cutting you to the ground and they grind you out and you get less touches offensively. This is a tough team to beat this time of the year.
Reynolds runs it to the 21-yard line. When we talked with Ken Niumatalolo this week, he said that this is probably the biggest game that he has ever coached in outside of the Notre Dame games and the Service Academy games. This has the most magnitude of any game that he's coached in, and this is certainly one of the biggest opportunities outside of Notre Dame and the Service Academy games that Navy football has had. Not only is it a win against the ranked teams and all that good stuff if they close this out, but they are in serious contention, along with Houston, for a New Year's Six bowl game. Let's not forget about that. Reynolds, with time running out, didn't like the look, and will step aside as well. 7:14 to play.
Navy.
Yep. second edition of the College Football Playoff Rankings. We've got the College Football Playoff Top 25 Rankings show Tuesday night, hosted by Reese Davis. 7 o'clock Eastern on ESPN, presented by Northwestern Mutual. With the full cast and crew to join Reese at the table and tell you all about what the breakdown's going to be like. And if Navy wins this game, you got to think that they take a leap into the top 25 of the college Certainly. Football playoff rankings. Don't forget, Memphis and Navy each still have to play against Houston, which is sitting at 9-0 and unbeaten. Second down 5 for Reynolds. And it's Swain grabbed up top by Hunter. Very close to the sticks. Third down and 1. And Navy in no hurry right now.
You talked about it, Adam. Navy has Houston down the road. But Memphis has to go to Houston, followed by a trip to Temple. I mean, they have tough sledding, to say the least. So Navy coming in here in this showing. They jump into the top 25. And they are in the, at least in the driver's seat in this conference, with Houston out in front of them.
They're down 1. They go to Swain here. They do. The guy who's got his fifth career 100-yard rushing game tonight keeps this drive alive for Navy. Yeah, let's not forget that, too. And let's not write the obituary on Memphis's season just yet. They are still well alive for the West Division Championship. But this would severely hurt their outside shot already at the college football playoffs. So that might be fading away quickly right now for Memphis. But the West Division and the New Year's Six Bowl is still up for grabs. More than likely, it's going to come out of the American between Navy, Memphis, Temple, or Houston, I would think, right?
That's what it appears to me. I think they certainly, this conference has an inside track for that New Year's Six pick.
First down and 10, Reynolds in the red zone. Swain again. And this is a big body. Most rushing yards that Memphis has allowed in over 8 years. You got to go back to November of 2007. The last time they gave up over 350 rushing yards.
And Memphis came into this game only giving up 119.
Yeah, they weren't bad.
However, a lot of that is because of the shootout type of games that they've been in.
They play a lot of spread offensive teams, certainly.
Yeah.
Pass the ball.
And teams that a lot of times were needing to throw the football to stay in games in that shootout mentality.
But 371 on the ground for Navy tonight. Reynolds is keeping it. Reynolds fighting, and he's about a half yard shy as Regis Ball caught up to him. We approach 5 minutes to play, lest we forget, as we haven't pounded it enough tonight. Keenan Reynolds is sitting at 77 career rushing touchdowns, still tied with Monte Ball. He said he would take the win over getting the record, but he would like the record and the win so he doesn't have to talk about the record anymore. Certainly been leading up to it all season long.
Well, how about get it all on this drive? You can see his family is standing up with that anticipation. A running clock, and then how about number 19 getting into the end zone?
Reynolds gonna run it left with a flag down. This is gonna be a free 5. Memphis was substituting furiously, and Reynolds alertly called for the snap, which will be a fresh set of downs.
Offside. Defense number 98. Half the distance to the goal. Results in a first down.
And not only does the anticipation build for one of the biggest wins in Navy football history, but now for Keenan Reynolds. Antioch, Tennessee, just a few hours away. 215 miles on I-40, northeast of Memphis. His mom, Jackie, his little brother, Quentin, his dad, Donnie, his first football coach. They're all here. Reynolds keeping it, trying to work forward, and he is inches away from the goal line. It'll be second down and goal.
Well, Navy is putting in extra offensive linemen. Robert Lindsay is in there as well, number 75. They're doing everything they can to get this ball in the end zone for Keenan Reynolds.
There's Lindsay, the sophomore out of Florida.
six offensive linemen and counting. We may be up to about eight or nine before this drives out.
Second and goal. Toss play, running right, another rushing touchdown for Navy. This one belongs to Damon Brown. And this one looks like it's going to be salted away by the midshipmen.
I think mom is happy they got in the end zone, but I think she would have appreciated it if 19 was the one carrying the football. Keenan Reynolds, I watched him after that play, and he truly was very excited that they got in the end zone, and that is the type of player he is. He would like to have that record, but I think it truly means more to him for them to come away with this huge win.
Brown with his fourth career rushing touchdown, and Reynolds, the winningest quarterback in Navy history. Assuming they close this one out, he'll tie Joel Stavi for third in terms of wins among active quarterbacks. Kevin Hogan and Stanford put it to Colorado earlier today. Connor Cook in a dogfight with Nebraska on the road tonight. But that's the type of kid that Keenan Reynolds is. We got a chance to talk with him this week, and you can tell he's very humble about it. And you get that sense from a lot of young men on this Navy roster. For those of you who haven't gotten a chance to really watch Navy football, again, these are not young men who are going to be necessarily playing at the next level like a Paxton Lynch is going to. We talked about contrast of styles. What about contrast of postgraduate?
No doubt.
These are young men that are going to be serving our country in some capacity after their football careers at Navy are over. That's what happens when you play at Army or Air Force or Navy. That's the main focus. 25-point Navy lead, and celebrating its 11th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for every field goal and extra point kick. To date, Allstate has contributed millions in scholarship funds.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting when you talk about Paxton Lynch as a redshirt junior can come out after the season. And right now, some are projecting him as the first quarterback taken in the draft. He'll be the face of an NFL team, and Keenan Reynolds will be serving our country somewhere in the world. That's the difference.
Frazier makes the catch. Let's not make it sound like we're disparaging anybody who doesn't serve the country. Obviously, we're not making it seem like that, but it's just a different contrast of what it means to go to a service academy to play football. Henderson has the first down, 3 minutes to play here.
Well, that mentality, that, I mean, it permeates what Navy does, right? It's what they do offensively because of the type of athlete that they're going to get at the Naval Academy.
Right.
So they run this triple option scheme. They play the defense they play because of the type of athlete they're going to get. And they do it with precision. And when they win the turnover takeaway, you simply can't beat them.
Mason and Anthony, the two edge rushers for Navy, closing in on Lynch with 2:40 to play. This conference has not been decided tonight, but this was one heck of a swing game. That's going to go in Navy's favor. Don't forget, Memphis, Houston, Memphis, Temple, Navy, Houston. Those games are still to come in this conference the rest of the way. And more than likely, you got to think that one of those four teams is going to end up in a New Year's Six bowl game. And they'll have another chance at a quality win against likely one of those other teams because they have an American Conference title game to play this year for the first time. Lynch under pressure. On the outside, Proctor diving ahead. Don't forget Monday Night Football tonight. A couple of quarterbacks in Jay Cutler and Phillip Rivers. Both looking to sling it. Phillip Rivers has had a massive season passing, but the Chargers have lost a bunch of one-score games. So have the Bears. A couple of two-win teams desperate for a win Monday Night Football on ESPN. Fourth down, caught by Proctor and short of the line to gain. And Navy will take over. And Proctor limping off the field, jumping off the field right now. Hopefully he's all right. This is what we were talking about. Next Saturday, Memphis and Houston in a massive matchup. Memphis has to play Temple. And don't forget, both of those games for Memphis are on the road. And then Navy against Houston on November the 27th, a week before the American Conference Championship game. Those are probably going to be the three biggest games in this conference the rest of the way.
Yeah, and Houston is at home with both of those games. Memphis
That's
next
right.
week and then Navy down the road. So Houston now is in a very good position. But I'm telling you right now, the Navy's going to be a tough out the rest of this season.
The winningest quarterback in Navy history said, we can do it if I don't score a rushing touchdown. He would have liked to have the record tonight, but they had to do it against Air Force without him scoring a rushing touchdown. And they're going to do it tonight as he spread the wealth. 377 rushing yards for Navy against Justin Fuente's defense. Earlier today, Air Force got a win over Army. So if Navy, after all is said and done in the American Conference, if they beat Army, they will take back the Commander-in-Chief's trophy. They'll win it for the 10th time in the last 13 years if they win that game in mid-December.
And if you talk to any of the Academy schools, including Navy right here, the Commander-in-Chief trophy is their emphasis every year.
Navy is going to go to 7-1 for the first time in 11 years. And Ken Niumatalolo in his 100th game as the head coach of Navy is going to come away with one of the biggest wins in program history. First win over an AP top 15 team in 31 years. And they knock Memphis from the ranks of the unbeaten. We're down to 8 unbeaten teams in college football. What a win for the midshipmen tonight.
When you play Navy, at the end of the day, it's about whose style of play wins out. And this is all about the way Navy wins football games here this evening.
The old styles make ball games cliche. Who's going to will or impose their will on the other team tonight? To the tune of 375 on the ground. It was Navy tonight with a 25-point monumental program victory. Keenan Reynolds again ran this triple option to near perfection in his home state. And a career night for Chris Swain with 3 rushing touchdowns. Down to the field, Ken Niumatalolo with Olivia.
Coach, people will be talking about this one for a long time, beating a top 15 at home. What does this say about your program?
Just really proud of our kids. And really at the end there, we were trying to get Keenan the ball, but he saw something, he checked the play, and he checked to another play, let one of his teammates score. Well, that just shows you kind of young man. He had a chance to break the record at home. He checked the play and I just told him that. I mean, that's why his kid's special.
Was that a priority for you to get him to break that record here in front of his home team?
Oh, it would have been nice, but he's just a great kid. You know what I mean? I just got so much love for this guy. It just happened.
Coach, thank you. Congratulations.
One of the biggest wins in Navy history. The record will wait. But right now, the midshipmen are undefeated in conference play. They are 7-1 for the first time in 11 years. They knock Memphis from the ranks of the unbeaten in dominant fashion, 45-20. Cal and Oregon are coming up. Back to the studio, college football scoreboard for Kelly and Olivia. Adam Amin, sing so long.